Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me.
Thank you very much for finding some time to come and be with us. Today we are talking about 1 Corinthians 13. It's a passage that talks about love, but the love that is talked about here has nothing to do with the love that we would want it to talk about, but it talks about agape love. But then James tells us of a story when he was a young man. James comes from a place in Bonn, and he tells us of a story when they were young. Every other time they would like visiting with their grandmother. And the grandmother would prepare very nice ponzu, and that was like a mark. Every other time they went to the village, that was their favorite. And it tasted the same for all the years. Throughout their teenage life, they loved the ponzu that was done by the grandmother. So when they were in secondary school, the ponzu tasted the same. Then when they went to college, one Easter, they visited with the grandmother. And as usual, the grandmother prepared the same ponzu. This time round, the ponzu tasted a bit different. And James was a bit courageous, and he asked the grandmother, "Grandma, what happened? Today is something totally off with this ponzu." And the grandmother laughed and she said, "The only missing ingredient in that ponzu is love. I did not have love when I was preparing that. Love makes all the difference." Friends, love is a difference. It is a difference in your life. In your life, love is a difference. It can tell the difference between a true friend and an acquaintance. Love is a difference between thought and action. Love is a difference between good and evil. Friends, love is a difference. You might have seen the movie, Love is a Wonderful Thing, Love is a Dangerous Thing. He also did another movie called Love is a Two-Way Street. Many people believe in the 50-50 rule of love. You love me, I love you back. You don't love me, I don't love you back. But see, the confusion that we have today about love was never the original intended meaning or intention of Paul. Instead, Paul was writing a reproach to a dysfunctional church in Corinth because of their abuse of their spiritual gifts. Remember, chapter 12 talks about the spiritual gifts. But then in this chapter, Paul urges that love is an action. Love is not an emotion. You know, the kind of love Paul is talking about is seen. This kind of love is experienced. This kind of love is demonstrated. This is very different from our culture that honors personal feelings above almost everything. We do what we want to do because we feel like it. And if we don't feel like it, then we will not do it. But then as we study this passage, we are struck by the complete absence of any emphasis on personal feelings. Because if love is an action, then I'm pushed to love them even when I don't feel like it. I am pushed to love them even when I don't feel like it. You know, a young man one day told me that, you know, this thing that you're telling us to love people, there's some people you meet up with them, but then there's no connection. They've not wronged you, you've not wronged them, you don't know them, but there's no connection. And you know, it's very powerful, Kikamba, you say it, you know, there's some people, you know, there's no connection. You know, there's no connection. How do you just tell me to love someone that I don't feel any connection, whether my brother, whether my sister, but then we are told, love them anyway. Praise the Lord. Amen. Then love, verse 1 to 3, chapter 13, verse 1 to 3, love is greater than any spiritual gift. In fact, towards the end of chapter 12, he says, I want to show you of a more excellent way. You know, love. And in these three verses, Paul mentions six spiritual gifts. He talks about the gift of prophecy, the gift of tongues, the gift of knowledge, the gift of faith, giving, and martyrdom, or sacrificing yourself. But then he says in verse 1, if I speak in the language of men and even of angels, but then I do not have love, then I'm just making a lot of noise. That means if everything that we do here in church, we don't have that ingredient called love, then whatever we do before the presence of the Lord is noise. Our singing, our giving, our hospitality is basically nothing before the Lord. And then he says, you can speak in tongues all you want, but if you don't have love, you're basically making a lot of noise. Then Paul mentions five more spiritual gifts when he writes, if I have the gift of prophecy, and the gift of all knowledge and of all faith, but do not have love, I am nothing. Paul declares that the greatest expression of spirituality is love. We could summarize these three verses like this. Without love, I say nothing. Without love, I am nothing. Without love, I gain nothing. We must have love when we are exercising our spiritual gifts. So stop for a moment and think about your own life and your activities here in church. Do you do whatever you do out of love? Or is this basically a sense of obligation or a sense of satisfaction that you draw from it? Is it coming from genuine love? Are you doing whatever you're doing out of love? Do you give out of love? Do you come to church out of love? Do you help your neighbor out of love? Paul says that love is an action, not an emotion. Therefore, we need to put feet to our love. And then secondly, verse 4 through 7, we're told that love is expressed by supernatural responses. Love is a word that can only be properly defined by our action, our attitude, and our behavior. When people look at you and how you do things, they can tell that this fellow is doing it out of genuine love. God wants us to know how love looks like when we see it. And therefore, he paints 15 separate portraits of love. He says, you know, in our modern definition of love, you know, this kind of love that is emotion, you know, or feeling. We love studying. We love football. We love our jobs. We love pizza. But then in the biblical definition of agape, love acts. For love is an action. Our favorite memory verse, John 3:16, says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. See how the definition of love grows from action to a person now, and from a what to a who. God is love. 1 John 4:7 says, dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. Praise the Lord. And then Romans chapter 8, verse 37 says, no, in all things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor demons, neither in the present, nor in the future, nor the powers in this creation will be able to separate us from the love of God. Because he is love. See how now verse 4 begins, summarizing love as being unselfish. Unselfish behavior. And then Paul says, love is patient. Love is kind. Let us examine them one by one. He says, love is patient. And the Greek language has several words for this patience. One signifies patience with, you know, in different circumstances. And the second bit signifies patience with people. You know? That means Paul seems to be saying that love does not have a short fuse. It doesn't lose its temper easily. A person who exercises agape love does not lose patience because love is patience. Because love is patient, man. As you grow in your Christian life, are you growing more and more patient? Or are you growing more and more impatient and difficult? God wants you and me to grow in patient love for those, you know, that we live with. He himself, being God, is very patient with us because he loved us and he continually loves us regardless of the many mistakes we make. And Romans 12:12 says, be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, and faithful in prayer. Love is patient. And number two, love is kind. Patience must be accompanied by a positive reaction of goodness towards the other person. Kindness, however, is not to be equated by giving everyone whatever they want. At times, we can love a love that is tough, a love that protects, a love that is ready to help. Kindness means withholding what harms as well as giving that which heals. Love is kind, but often tough. Being able to help, giving out of compassion, helping. I'm reminded of this gentleman shares his testimony in a prayer meeting. He's a very established advocate now. You know, he has a law firm in Syokimau, and he has another law firm in Nairobi. And he says one day, you know, he was doing his, you know, daily routine, and then a young man had just cleared class 8. And then this young man was just walking around looking for anyone to help him to go to secondary school. And the mother was selling porridge. And then this gentleman looks at this young man and says, what is wrong with you? And the young man expressed himself and he said, you know, I cleared class 8. This is the marks that I got, but then my mom cannot pay my school fees. And then this wakil was so moved. And then he told the young man, go call your mom and calculate how much you need for the 4 years in school. And the young man went, came with the mother, did the math. It was around 340,000 for the 4 years. And this wakili wrote a check and he paid the whole fees. One off. And then he gave some money for pocket, you know, money. And then he said that when he did that, he forgot about it. And the young man went to school, studied for 4 years, and he sat for his KCSE, and he passed, actually got a B. And then after 4 years, he comes back, and he's helping his mother to, you know, wash some clothes and like that, get 500 to go to the store and buy some flowers, go to the office of this wakili and basically say thank you. And this young man buys flowers and goes to the office after 4 years. And then he meets this wakili, and this wakili cannot remember him. The young man, you know, tries to remind him, and the gentleman remembers. And he says that thing moved his heart because, you know, he sobbed, he was moved because he says he has helped people, he supported people, but no one has ever come back to say thank you. And then he looked at the young man and he says, forget about whatever you want to do. As from today, you'll be working in this law firm. And you'll go to college from this law firm. And as we talk today, the young man in his fourth year. Kindness. Helping. Kindness. Paul followed these two positive expressions from love with 8 verbs that indicate how love does not behave. He says, love is not jealous. See, jealous implies being displeased with the success of others. Yet true love desires the success of others. You see, the best way to cure envy is to pray sincerely for the one of whom you are jealous. Nelson Mandela once told us that overcoming your enemies is working with them. If you want to overcome that feeling of not loving someone, try to love them. Pray for them. Demonstrate your love. Then he says, one, love is not jealous. And second, love does not brag. Praise the Lord. Love does not brag. Love does not show off. Love is not big-headed, but love is big-hearted. This means that the more loving you become, the less cocky you need to do. The greater your spiritual gifts, the less prone you should be to bragging. And after all these gifts have been graciously given to us. If I have the gift of healing, I have to exercise that in the body of Christ for the edification of the body of Christ. Friends, our leader the other day had summoned all the pastors and he was explaining to us. He was talking about humility as pastors. And then he said that one of the pastors in his DCC is no longer with AIC now, but he was so full of himself. He said one day he stood up in a prayer meeting and he started bragging of the number of suits he's got. And he said he's got over 100 suits and over 200 shoes. He is a man talking about over 200 shoes. You see, if it was a lady talking about 200 shoes, maybe we could understand. But this is a man talking about he has 200 pairs of shoes and 150 suits. And then the leader says, a few years before the bragging, the church did funds right and bought this pastor a piece of land. The church did a second pyramid and put up a house for this pastor. And the church did a third pyramid and bought this pastor a car. And now he's bragging about something very unfortunate as just having a number of suits. In fact, Luke chapter 3 says, anyone who has two shirts, let him give the neighbor one. He has 150 and over 200 pairs of shoes. One is wasifiwe. Love does not brag. Of what value will that add? You see, if your pastor had one suit and he was properly preaching Christ and we all go to heaven, how beautiful would that be? And if your pastor here has 150 suits and all of you are not transformed and rooted in Christ, of what value will that be? Love does not brag. Love does not show off, and then love is not arrogant. You see, arrogance means always considering yourself excused, thinking that you're better, you're important. Arrogance disrespects others and makes one feel better than others. But then God calls us to serve others and to be generous towards them. There's a gentleman called Frazier says, arrogance is trying to convince others that you are more than who they know you are. Then number 6, we are told, love, it does not act unsuitably. This word is best translated rude. Love is not rude. You see, there are some Christians who seem to take delight in saying something in the name of being blunt and truthful, and they end up hurting and breaking people's hearts, in the process. You've heard people arrogantly say, that is who I am, and I say it as it is. And another statement that, in due respect, in all respect, when a statement begins like that, whatever is coming after is not good. when someone says, in all respect, or in due respect, no, I do not know how to lie. I do not know how to beat corners. I say it as it is. And the saying it as it is meant to embarrass a brother in Christ. Love does not act unsweetened. There is a way that you can correct someone out of love. There's a way you can correct someone without embarrassing them. And then we are told love is not selfish. Love is not possessive. Love is not demanding. Love is not stubborn. Love is not controlling. Love does not talk too much. but love listens as well. Love does not insist on its own way, but love is always willing to consider, and love puts others first. And then we are told love is not easily provoked. Love and truth are basically the same. God is love and God is truth. Then number 9, we are told love does not take into account a wrong suffered. Paul uses the normal word here for bookkeeping, that love does not keep a ledger of evils done. You know, love does not keep a record of evil. Love does not keep a record of evil. If someone has wronged you, you do not have to keep a record. In fact, I was told the other day of a lady who, you know, when they go for counseling, she has a file for the last 8 years of the things the husband has done. Very well dated. In fact, she has noted down even the dressing, the jacket, and the color the husband had worn that day. You know, they're going to this therapist and she has a file. December 23rd, 2008, he did this. Love does not keep a record of wrongs, because love is always forgiving. And then we are told number 10, love does not rejoice in unrighteousness. Love does not take joy in evil of any kind. It does not take pleasure in the insufficiencies or mistakes or shortcomings or sins of other people. Love is righteous. Then now, after 8 sobering negatives, now Paul gives us some glorious positives. He says, now love rejoices with the truth. Truth must make our love discerning, and love must make our truth compassionate and forgiving. If our actions are, you know, in accord with agape love, then we'll always welcome biblical correction and biblical truths. And then we are told love bears all things. Bearing means covering something. Love protects other people. It does not transmit bad news. It goes the second mile to protect another person's reputation. You know, I love you so much to protect you. I would not want to expose you to the world, but I would want to have this one-on-one with you. Let us work this out. Love protects one another. Love protects the other person's reputation. Love does not condemn. Love does not point out every defect of the ones that you love. The love does not criticize in public. This is perhaps Paul's primary meaning. Love does not do its dirty laundry for the entire world to see. Love covers. You know, love bears all things, and love does not seek to embarrass. Even some jokes are very embarrassing. Might seem to be jokes to you, but that might be embarrassing to the other person. You know, and maybe my interpretation was wrong, but then I had a gentleman introduce his wife and he made some jokes, and to me I think that was very sensitive. The wife is a bit, you know, for lack of a better word, let me say huge. You know, she is a bit huge. And then the husband stands and says, you know, my wife loves eating, that is the reason she's like a mountain. You know, if you say that in Kikamba, now, you know, doesn't sound very good. And to him that is funny. But to the rest of us, that is embarrassing, your wife. Love does not embarrass. You remember the visiting pastor one day told us that, you know, love has a way of love, you know, bearing with one another. Even when you wrong one another. And he gives us a story of this pastor who did not have a good time with the wife in the morning. They quarreled, and some of them, I think, they had some fight because he used to fight. And then the pastor had a sermon, and then he beat up his wife in the morning, and then he came as everything was okay. And then he said, no, in air, still, you can only tell, you can well tell when it's about someone, or it's about giving time, or it's about doing the benedictions. So we can tell how the program goes. And so the wife, you know, it's a time for the sermon, and the wife comes. When the pastor is busy preaching, he sees his wife show up, carrying a briefcase and another bag on this side. And then she comes in front, and then she takes the keys and throws to the pastor. And then she says this in Kikamba. In other words, and after you're done, please go and take care of your cattle or your goats. Because they're not bearing with one another. They're not sorting their issues well. Love does not embarrass one another. Love bears all things. Even if they have wronged you, how? Love bears one another. Praise the Lord. Love bears with one another. And then we're told love believes all things. Love is always ready to allow for explanatory circumstances. You see, people tend to become what you believe them to be. They either live up or down to your expectations. If you treat a man as trustworthy, he will strive to prove himself worthy of trust. But then if you trust a man as not trustworthy, then chances are he will live up to that. But then we are told, love believes all things. Love believes in it. As much as that relationship is not working, I strongly believe that you can sort your issues and it can work. That is what Jesus did to indecisive Simon. He said, Simon, you are a rock. To the prostitute, he said, your sins are forgiven. To the woman caught in infidelity, he said, neither do I condemn you. When he said that you're the rock, that gentleman lived up to being the rock. If he said that your sins are forgiven, that woman went away feeling like her sins have been forgiven. Friends, when he said, neither do I condemn you, go and sin no more. It is a simple power of believing the best and not the worst. Believing the best out of someone. Then number 14, we are told love hopes in all things. Paul is suggesting that love refuses to take failure as final. Either in oneself or in someone else. Love never gives up on people. And the reason the believer can take such attitude is because God is in the business of taking human failure and producing spiritual giants out of them. And he can do that with me. He can do that with you. He says, love endures all things. Love won't stop loving, even in the face of rejection. Love takes action to shake up, even in situations which are unbearable. Love endures all things. And then verse 13, which is a punch, and he says, now this will remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of them is love. You see, the reason as to why love is the greatest of them all. Today, we live in hope that one day we'll see Jesus. We have faith that one day we'll see Jesus. And we still have love, we love him. But the moment we see Christ face to face, that will be the end of hope, and that will be the end of faith. Because we have seen all that we have been anticipating for. And the only thing that will remain is to love Jesus forevermore. And that's the reason love is the greatest of them all. Friends, for we know in part, and we prophesy in part, but when the perfect comes, the partial will be done away with. You know, when we see Christ, we will understand everything. And who will be made perfect. Friends, as I conclude, how will we grow in our love for others? One, I would suggest that you cannot become a loving person that you desire to be apart from a loving and vibrant relationship with God. This love relationship must be cultivated first and foremost. You cannot give that which you do not have. The love talked about here stems from a source, and we have to be connected to this source so that our love will unceasingly and unendingly flow. Because we are tapping this love from our source. I do not know whether you have been in this situation, that someone you don't feel like them, but then you pray about it. Maybe someone you work together with, maybe someone you go to school together with, or maybe someone you live in the same neighborhood and you have to, you know, keep interacting every other time. But then you ask God to give you the grace to bear, to be, you know, to live with them well. And somehow, by God's grace, you're able to go up with them. Because you're asking this from a source. And secondly, this love does not end with you. You must love those around you. This means that if you're a student, love your classmates. If you are, you know, you're at work, give love to fellow workmates. Once you have accomplished this, then you will be able to love the world around you. Number three, God has called us to love people, even when they don't appreciate and welcome our love. Love them anyway. John 13:34 says, "And all these people will know that you're my disciples if you have love for one another." If you love one another, then people will say, "Truly, these are my disciples." We have statistics as at April 2020, and we are told that 4.4 billion people in the world feel unloved and unappreciated. That is actually more than 60% of the population. They feel unloved, unappreciated. Friends, if you have never believed in Jesus Christ as your Savior, will you do so today? Will you give your life to the Lord? Not only will He give you the gift of His eternal love, but He will also allow you to love the way He intended for you to love. Friends, may you seek to love your neighbor as you love yourself. May you seek to grow in your love for God and for others. May the word of God richly dwell in your hearts. And may you live to enjoy the love and the doings of the Lord in your generation. And may goodness and mercy follow you all the days of your life. Amen. And may the Lord grant you the desire and the heart to love God and to love His people. Because that is our calling. Love God and love God's people. If you forget everything, please take this with you. Love God and love God's people. Ask God to increase you in the love for Him and the love for His people. May we stand and let's hear the words of grace. Our Father and our God, we thank you because you've encouraged us today to love one another and to put on the ingredient of love. To love you first and to love the people that we live with and to love the people that we serve and to love the people around us and to love the world. Lord, I pray for these brothers and sisters that you will increase them in love, that they may love one another, that they will be rich in love, and that, Lord, your grace will be sufficient for them. Bless them and keep them as we face the new week. Lord, may you protect us and may your grace be sufficient. You're here this morning and you're saying, "That someone comes to me. I want the Lord to increase me in love for some people that I've tried loving, but then it is not working. Let me see by a show of hand. There is someone that you want to love, you've tried, but then it's not working. Let me see." Just raise up your hand well. Thank you for those hands. May the Lord increase. May the Lord increase you in that love. Maybe someone is saying that, "I'm supposed to love someone, but then I've not been loving them well. I want the Lord to forgive me and to give me another opportunity to love them better, to love them more. The people that I work together with, my colleagues, I don't love them as I should." And you want the Lord to forgive you and increase your love. Let me see by a show of hands. Thank you for those hands. May the Lord forgive you. And may the Lord increase you in love for them. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God
and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen. May the Lord be with you.
Love lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Love lifted me. Love.